Chequers, bequeathed to the nation by Lord Lee of Farham as a country retreat for British prime ministers and their respective spouses.
Thatcher, T-H-A-T-C-H-E-R.
Testing, testing. 1, 3, 4, 2, 6, 5, 8. Appreciate.
Ah, wonderful.
Just with Daniel.
Wonderful drinking weather and a thoroughly worthwhile working weekend in prospect.
I trust you're not contemplating any high jinks this weekend, Mr. Thatcher.
Morning, Admiral. Not quite sure. I follow your drift.
I'm talking about the trail of vandalism and destruction left behind last Michaelmas, when your friend Mr. Sticky Wilkinson dropped in, as he put it, for a cup of tea. The art historians employed by the Chequers Trust do not take kindly to removing ginger moustaches and cross eyes painted on valuable portraits of Pitt the Younger, and they call themselves conservatives.
Hello, Bill. Me, Obin. He who trails along in the perfumed wake, hands behind the back, the embarrassing appendage, what? No, you beef, of course it's not the Duke of Edinburgh. It's Denis. Denis T. Well, I'm not allowed to say Thatcher over the phone. Margaret's just tightened up the security arrangements, sir. Huh? It's actually been rather a good year for spies. It seems one only has to break wind and they come hopping out of the woodwork like cockroaches. No, the thing is, the proprietor has got her knickers in rather a twist about the euro contributions. It seems they are diddling her again, so she's shot off to Brussels to try and extract a largish rebate from the oily frog, leaving me in sole charge of the entire gin palace, fully staffed, so I thought you might all like to toddle over, what? No, no, feel no qualms. There is a whiff of an election in the air, and Margaret is splashing out as if there was no tomorrow. She's even squandered £31 million, would you believe, on the Falklands. Well, it works out about £1 million per sheep. Now, it's not real money nowadays, of course. I mean, British Steel loses that on a Wednesday afternoon. Well, she is also refurbishing the Royal Navy, I'm glad to say. A frightful little knot has been forced to perform an instant U-turn in public before waddling off like the legendary Ouslam bird to vanish up his own fundamental orifice. No doubt his successor will restore the cuts. Next task force will consist of one frogman with a water pistol and the wreck of the Mary Rose. No, the nuclear alternative is not popular. A lot of women in pork pie hats and cigars have been lying about legs akimbo outside some American Air Force base at Greenham Common. Very unwise, in my view, knowing the randiness of the average American doughboy. No, Margaret doesn't agree. She talks about what she calls negotiating from strength. Well, I think she means if they do it again, she'll climb into a chieftain tank and run them all over several times. I think success may actually rather go into her head. She's been posing recently for snaps of herself as the Madonna and Child. Mercifully not with the boy Mark in her arms, and also as a kind of space-age bird seer hopping in and out of the cockpit of a Harrier jet. I mean, I've always been in favor of the little woman having a job, but I hadn't exactly banked on her taking over the leadership of the entire Western world. Oh, thank you, Boris. What? No, of course I've not plastered you, silly ass. That wasn't me. No, that was Boris. I don't know, some sort of general factotum introduced, I think, under an exchange arrangement by Harold Wilson. Entrepreneurial thing, something of a rough diamond. Definitely not a gent. Tendency to scratch his arse and spit on the floor and so forth. Definitely not a gent. I say, that's bloody rum. No, just some kind of echo coming off the panelling. Look, as I say, for once in a blue moon, the coast would appear to be entirely clear. And I thought, while the cat is away, the mice might play, what? I've already alerted Maurice Picardo and the Major. They are hastening hither on winged wheels and pretty well tanked up by the sound of it, even as I speak. Hasta la vista to you, as the artist said when he saw Johnny Gurkha coming for him with a carving knife. Ah, Boris, I thought the plan of attack for tomorrow morning might go roughly as follows.
Plan of attack?
Our breakfast, in the form of a largish snort and a packet of medium to low tar cigarettes brought to our bedsides on a tray about 10:30. Not quite sure by whom. The staff shall rotate. By nightfall, they rotate so fast they're little more than a blur, but I find they're fairly reliable in the mornings. Then it'll be time for 11s, as obviously line up the G&Ts. Sharpener or twain down at the wagon load of monkeys in Great Missenden. Pre-lunch snifters, a little frog place I've discovered up the Aylesbury Road. Slap-up meal, obviously all the trimmings. Brownie and soda down at the golf course. Tinctures with the Widow Everett, and by then the sun should be over the yard arm and we can all trickle back here for some really serious drinking.
Snifters, tinctures, G&Ts, lotions, snorts and brownies. Secret language, I must crack on with me. It's my duty.
Just like being back on the board at Burma Oil in the old days. Ah, I shall need your assistance. You're new here, aren't you?
Yes, sir. I am the temporary help.
Mr.
Jenkins, sir.
Aren't you marginally involved in politics yourself, to some extent?
Peripherally, yes, sir.
What the hell are you doing here?
Waiting, sir. To be frank, confronted with a rather distressing breed of roughneck one rubs up against in the Liberal Party, no names, no pack drill. I thought this situation preferable as representing the middle way. I've always been tremendously in favour of moderation. Now, sir, can I provide some assistance?
Yes, you most certainly can. I'm expecting guests, a party of gentlemen.
Really, sir, I'm rather a dab hand at getting parties off the ground. Shall I serve some rare vintage claret?
No, gin, I think. A litre bottle, shall we say, 36?
Questions of supply and demand are rather beyond my province, sir, but I will make representation to our administrator, the Admiral.
Oh, and Jenkins, I shall require a glass, otherwise I shall be obliged to suck it out through the cork.
What? Very good, sir.
I rather like the cut of his jib, Boris. He can certainly spot a gent when he sees one.
A gent? In telephone you say are definitely not a gent.
Oh, of course you are, Boris, one of nature's.
You are agent.
Well, I like to think so. Certainly the doorman at the Savoy Grill doesn't exactly spit in one's eye.
Sir Anthony Blunt, also agent.
Yes, absolutely. A gent of the old school. Old Malburin, to be precise, but crikey, Boris, what a roarer.
Roarer.
Your intelligence is remarkable.
Oh, come along here, boy. I wasn't born yesterday. I mean, it stood about a mile off. The man was there on Dirty Bertie.
But the doctor?
I don't know whether the word service means anything to you, Admiral. You are a member of the senior service in which you serve as a senior officer with, I would surmise, a good deal of service under your belt. What you perhaps do not understand is who you are there to serve. Under a conservative regime, you are there to serve me. And just at this precise moment, I would like you to serve me a very large gin and tonic. As to my plans for the weekend, if I choose to entertain Attila the Hun and the entire Washington chapter of the Mafia, with or without Nancy Reagan, you will entertain them too at the salutes, have you?
Sir.
And I shall want a full muster parade of the staff to discuss how best my guests can be supplied with drink.
A chain of buckets, perhaps?
Morning, sir. Detective Inspector Eric Catchpole, on attachment from the Special Patrol Group.
The SPG? Oh, crikey, I say this is an honour. I've been a fan of your group for years. You're the ones who clubbed down the peasantry with the weighted shillelaghs.
Not with weighted shillelaghs, no, sir. The official inquiry into the event to which you allude established beyond all reasonable doubt that all the clubs, bludgeons, cudgels, life preservers, burglars, friends, and the big round heavy metal ones with the spikes sticking out were in fact collector's pieces, privately assembled by the officers in question with an interest in antiques.
Yeah, well, I'll drink to that. And I hope you'll join me, Inspector. What's your poison?
No, thank you, sir.
Oh, come along, just a quick one, not on duty, surely.
No, thank you, sir. I'm, in fact, a militant teetotaler. You probably haven't seen our pamphlet, sir. Postmortems, photographed in technicolour of the havoc wrought by alcoholic poisoning.
Good Lord, that's old Squiffy Hetherington. Certainly looks a good deal more lively than the last time I saw him. Well, I mustn't detain you, Inspector. I'm sure you're a jolly busy officer.
I would prefer it, sir, if you called me Eric.
Why on earth should I call you Eric?
Because I've just been appointed as your personal bodyguard, sir. You may rest assured I shan't let you out of my sight for a minute.
Hell's teeth!
Oh, yes. There's nothing much escapes the eye of Eric Catchpole.
Mr. Dennis. Can I speak to you agent to agent? There is a little problem concerning snifters.
Maybe a little problem to you, Boris. To me, it's a cosmic bloody catastrophe.
What, didn't you? GNTs?
Exactly. Mais pas devant le flat foot. Drinking?
Flat foot. Foot flat.
I wonder if I could trouble you, sir, for some means of identification.
By all means. Foot Michael, born 1861, that's fascinating.
Well, that all seems to be in order. Thank you, Lord Lucan.
Jenkins, I thought I called for a full muster parade of the staff. Where, for instance, is Cook?
You are referring, no doubt, sir, to Mr. Wu, the former boat person.
Exactly. Chinky, chinky, Chinaman. Chop, chop, chop.
I'm afraid that won't be possible, sir.
Why ever not?
Mr. Wu has asked me to convey his deep sense of grievance, sir, at being asked to provide hospitality during what was agreed should be a free weekend.
I beg your pardon?
In common with the rest of the staff, he is making his protest in the form of a go slow, a work to rule, something of that nature. I'm not really familiar with their vocabulary, sir.
Civilian filth.
My guests are highly respected captains of industry. I want this weekend to run like oil clockwork. Highly oiled clockwork.
In that case, sir, you'll have to rely on the Admiral and myself to provide it.
Speak for yourself, Jenkins. I joined the Navy to see the world, not to muck out after pigs in suits.
Right, that does it. I'll have Margaret abolish the whole Royal Navy first thing Monday morning.
Chequers House, Rear Admiral Braithwaite speaking.
What? Arriving at the main gate now? Action stations! Whoop, whoop, whoop!
Admiral?
An emergency, Jenkins. Stow the ropes, break out the hoover.
What is going on?
Come along, Inspector. Take these.
Moving dash sheets isn't within my responsibility, Admiral. I am security, not interior decor.
We in the armed services cleared up after you at the Iranian embassy siege, Inspector. I think the least you can do is to reciprocate. At the double.
Someone tell me what is going on, and in the absence of my handler, Admiral, what happened to my drink?
Whose drink it is, Mr. Thatcher, it is not my place to debate. Such drink as there is will remain under lock and key until the Prime Minister arrives.
Well, the Prime Minister is locked in a room full of Walloons in darkest Belgium with the earphones strapped to her head, haggling about the price of beetroot.
The Prime Minister will be arriving in 1 minute and 20 seconds precisely.
What? But she'll run bang slap into Maurice Picard and the Major. I must hit them all.
Trouble?
Force Eta imminent. Hoist storm code.
Must warn the Kremlin.
Stand by your beds. The Prime Ministerial limousine is just turning in at the main gate.
What is this wire?
Tropical daffodils. They cannot survive without heat.
Poor things. Take them out and talk to them.
Hello, hello, hello.
Dennis.
Ah, Margaret.
What do these mean?
Well, I suppose that was fairly obvious, darling.
Not to me.
This one?
Dennis, as Tories, we respect other people's property. That's why we had to clobber General Galtieri, because the Falkland Islands were not his property. They belong to the company that makes coalite. Collecting road signs is the kind of silly undergraduate prank you get up to with your disreputable friends, Dennis. And you know what I think about them.
Only too well, darling.
Margaret Hilda Thatcher, Prime Minister of Great Britain and parts of Northern Ireland.
Is she, Miss Chequers? Trump!
Thank you, Inspector. Please bring in the visitor's luggage.
Madam.
Hello, Admiral. How are you?
Since you ask, Prime Minister, hopping mad.
Hopping mad? In what way, Admiral?
Well,
hello, Roy. Water, please.
But, madam...
Now, our guests will be arriving at any moment, so let's sort out their luggage, shall we? Monsieur le Comte Vouvray de Chambertin.
Powder blue vanity bag and matching etui.
Lloyd George Annex, king-size double bed, bidet ensuite.
But, madam, these sudden changes of plan...
Adjustments, Admiral.
Adjustments?
First, the conference is to be held in Belgium.
Yes, that was our intention, and we're sticking to it.
Then, without any warning, the conference is to be held here.
Yes, that was our intention, too, and we're sticking to that.
Am I going mad?
Probably, but I shall need notice of that question. Now, there's Monsieur Vouvray, Herr Schubert, and the American envoy, Mr. Fitz.
But, madam, the staff are in a ferment. There is dark murmurings of mutiny.
I always knew it was a mistake to put a woman in any position of responsibility.
Ask Jenkins, Prime Minister.
Well, Roy, can't they see? We're beginning to get things under control at last.
No, Madam Prime Minister, for some reason they can't. A lack of political experience, ignorance, prejudice, who knows with the proletariat.
What's causing the trouble now?
If memory serves, they're called the unions, Margaret.
Well, Margaret, you know my point of view on this one.
Yes, Denis, I do.
Have you said this before?
Yes, Denis, I have.
And I've no doubt you'll hear me say it again.
I'm sure I shall.
You come in with a rock-solid mandate to club the bloody unions back into the stonehenge, and who do you wheel out the moment it comes to any kind of confrontation but first Pinko Pryor, now this frightful little egg-splattered ex-airline pilot Norman Tebbit, who is, in my humble opinion, about as much use as a one-legged man at an arse-kicking party.
Wild pigskin valise with oriental hat cross motif.
Winston Churchill bunker, own shower, shared toilet. What now?
There would appear to be some general agitation below stairs for more generous emoluments, ma'am.
He means the civilians want more money.
Roy, I've explained over and over again, we can't earn more than we spend, or vice versa.
But inflation, Prime Minister. Take, for instance, Mr. Wu's noodles.
Why should I take Mr. Wu's noodles, Admiral?
Because inflation is putting noodles out of reach of the ordinary man in the street.
Especially if he's a Chinaman. They have rather shorter legs than the rest of us, ma'am. What is it? The last to know when it's raining, the first to know there's a flood. Bubble.
Now listen to me, all of you. Of course the rate of inflation is still high, and unemployment figures are still rising. But you can't seriously expect me or the Conservative government to take responsibility for things like that. If they start to fall dramatically, then of course we shall. Full responsibility. But you know, if there's one thing I've tried to get across again and again, it is this. Whatever happens, it's your fault. You elected us, and with the Tories in power, the cost of living is inevitably going to be very high indeed, because we Tories believe in good living, and that's going to cost the rest of you a great deal of money.
Jolly good, Margaret. Yar, 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 yar.
Finally, can I just say one other thing? Lord Scarman blames some of the troubles in our inner cities on mindless hooligans motivated solely by personal greed. Well, that may be true, but it's no way to talk about the Tory party.
Bravo, jolly good old girl.
Now, Roy, if you'd make that speech to the other members of the working classes behind the Green Baize door.
Very good, madam. For Social Democrats, there may be some very minor variations, but the relevant passages will be repeated verbatim.
Oh, I thought that went rather well.
Margaret, you would have thought the Titanic's maiden voyage went rather well.
Inspector, if you would take up a position outside the front door, ready with a wave of welcome the moment you see Monsieur Vouvray's chopper.
Is what?
His helicopter.
Madam.
Admiral, the American envoy, Mr. Hamilton Thist, will be arriving independently.
Hamilton Thist? Not that grisly Sicilian geriatric of the ill-fitting wig they wheeled out after dinner at the White House to sing his 100 best tunes.
No, Denis, that was Frank Sinatra. And don't go slinking off. I want a nice long chat while I'm soaking in my bath.
I thought I might just find myself a little drink, darling, since no one else seems inclined to do so.
No, Denis, the Admiral has her orders. The cellar remains locked until our European guests arrive.
Thank you, Leader. I'm sorry to be so touchy. I'll bend over backwards, strain every sinew, bust the gut. The bulldog breed.
Whoa.
Economy, Denis, you know it makes sense.
I.E. F.H.B. Family hold back. This isn't the first time this has happened in Rome, Margaret. The only decent bottle of malt whiskey I've had in the house in the last year, I had to see guzzled before my very eyes by the head leprechaun, Hockey, or whatever his name is, shifty little Irish sod. If it's not him, it's Mr. Sidney Weehell. Now it's the bloody Urios hurling it down their throats like a burst water mill.
Denis, this has not been an easy day, and Dr. Melrose thinks I may be suffering from metal fatigue. Oh, if you could only hold my hand.
What, now, darling?
No, it's too late now. I realized long ago I must face these challenges alone, one frail woman against the world. But if you could just say one small word of support or reassurance, I know it would make all the difference.
Green?
Do you know what I'd like you to say? I'd like you to say you can do it, Margaret.
You can do it, Margaret.
Of course I can do it, Denis. I don't need you to tell me that. I've done it. I've done it for you all over and over again, like all this muddle here today. Of course, you couldn't be expected to organize anything as complicated as putting two people's luggage in their bedrooms. That's what I'm there for, Denis, to do things like that, you see. I've already thrashed the cabinet single-handed over the fence cuts this morning and papered the blue drawing room at number 10. Now tell me, what have you been doing?
Very quiet this morning, darling.
Yes?
While I was shaving, an immense purple orangutan burst out of the bathroom cupboard and tried to strangle me.
Yes?
Holding it back with one hand when a full-grown anaconda reared up out of the loo and wrapped its entire slimy length round my left pajama leg.
Yes.
Smashed the mighty serpent's head over the toilet pedestal and used its now inert coils to lasso the wayward ape. Otherwise, not a bad stab, but the Daily Telegraph Junior crossword puzzle.
Poor Denis, you must be absolutely exhausted. Oh, I am looking forward to this, aren't you?
What's that, darling?
A nice long soak and a chat, and then I think I'll slip into something more uncomfortable.
What? Despite our stringent security arrangements, I don't believe it.
Trouble, Inspector?
An automobile accident down by the main gate, sir. Some old boiler not flying into a ditch. Couple of drunken drivers made off into the grounds on foot.
Not Maurice Picardo and the men.
Don't worry, sir. I'll have them.
That's what I'm afraid of.
Yes!
Come in, darling.
Top-level NATO conference in progress, Chequers House. British master mole Denis Thatcher warns Force 10 imminent. Storm cones hoisted. Weapons include snifters, tinctures, lotions, snorts, brownies, and GNTs.
I bloody hate pedestrians, Maurice. They're a menace to the ordinary law-abiding motorist, especially when he's got a police car sitting on his arse. Did you hear the names that woman called me? Foul-mouthed old cow, and the motor's a write-off.
I think the coast is clear.
Hold that one, Maurice, I'll bottle it.
I certainly shook off that police car. There's a circus genius doing that U-turn through the Cheshire. Tombstones going boing, boing, and police sirens going boing, boing.
Yes, I wonder it wasn't a mistake to let you drive. This is all your fault, making stupid bloody bets in the bar of the RAC Club. Last one to finish 4 pints of vodka and limes and sissy. Then you go hairing out the club, shove me into Lord Gormley's waiting limousine, and roar off down pell-mell like a sodding moon rocket.
With the chauffeur still washing his hands up against the near side back wheel.
Denis! Denis!
The policeman come back and warm me up, she creaking barbed wire canoe without pedals.
Icy calm. We're perfectly safe. We're inside Chequers. Say Denis Thatcher.
Denis Thatcher.
What?
You said say Denis Thatcher.
Maurice. Do try and concentrate. We got diplomatic immunity.
What?
Well, it's like being in Buckingham Palace.
At Buckingham Palace, you do not hear the scream of sirens in the middle of the night, flashing lights, vice squad pounding up the stairs, all in all the Duke of Edinburgh's guests out in their wife runs, or slapping him up against the wall for a quick frisk.
Why not?
Because his old lady runs the country. No, Denis. Only Denis's missus does it for real. Now, all we've got to do is to find Denis.
Denis! Just entering the royal residence. No sign of Her Majesty at this present time. I'll be in closest touch. But remember, whatever happens, don't wake the president.
Look, I'm afraid this part of the house is out of bounds to tourists.
This is the hotline to Washington. The president likes to be kept in touch with developments as, when, and where they develop. But obviously, I didn't want to disturb him during his working siesta. Hamilton Thisbe, glad to have you know me, young man.
I will inform the proprietor you have arrived.
No, I won't ride, thank you. Her Gracious Highness, the Princess Anne, has offered Mrs. Thisbe and I a sightseeing excursion in her pony and crab. Just a moment. Eyeglasses, average height, dapper appearance. You must be the late Lord Carrington.
No, I am not.
Oh, so you're not.
No, I am not Lord Carrington.
Glad to have you know me, Mr. Nutt.
Margaret!
Well, will you look at that? What an exquisite piece of art deco.
Right, son. You're nicked. Multiple motoring offences, breaking and entering. You're not obliged to speak, but anything you say may be used in evidence. No reply. Thank you. Hiya!
Inspector, what do you think you're doing? Dragging muddy boots across the carpet.
I'm sorry, Admiral.
Clement Attlee's Namdar rug, a gift from India in exchange for independence. Police indeed. Slovens. And they talk of arming them.
Maurice!
You animal!
Forgive him, madam. He is taking pills for it. Permit us to introduce ourselves. We are closer personal friends of Denis Thatcher.
I might have guessed it. Inspector?
Inspector! Maurice, pull yourself together. Try and act like a member of the government.
Gotcha! Right, up against the wall, come on.
I always like to help the police with their inquiries, but I'm sure there's been some mistake. If you care to look in my back pocket, you'll find some fielding money as a contribution towards the policeman's board.
I am a member of the government and a close friend of the Duke of Edinburgh, not to mention, for obvious security reasons, I'm...
Well done, Inspector. This could mean promotion for you.
The Admiral, the...
Ladies!
Are these men known to you, sir?
No, I've never seen either of them before in my entire life.
What?
No doubt they are innocent members of the public who've strayed in, little realizing the Prime Minister is unexpectedly in residence.
This is typical. Your lot gets in, Thatcher, tells staunch Conservatives like Maurice and Iha it's going to be the life of Riley, income tax at tuppence in the pound, numbered bank accounts in Switzerland, and what happens? Since you were elected, Maurice Iha has gone bankrupt 19 times. Now we come down to spend the weekend with our old chum, and he denies every knowledge of our existence.
Denis, don't do that. Gentlemen, hello. You're early, how nice.
Prime Minister, these...
Not now, Admiral. I hope you had a good crossing.
It was a crossing, more like a roundabout. He came out in the RAC and shot off up pell mell. Chauffeur still having us all up against the wheel of the car, and then straight on the A29, and then turned right through the churchyard, left through the kindergarten, and the Mercedes went kaput.
You must be Herr Schubert.
Schubert?
My German is not very good.
No German's any bloody good. The only good Germans are dead Germans. Do you know? I strangled 9 of them with my bare hands at Monte Cassino.
I beg your pardon.
Monte Cassino.
Monte
casino.
Ah, si, si. Comprendo un poco.
Poco?
Si, si. Non parlo italiano, ma comprendo un poco.
Loco.
Come along, Denis. Don't be shy.
And Minister.
Not now, Admiral. Ah, Monsieur le Comte, vous vrai de Chambertin.
Oui, oui. Comment allez-vous? Voulez-vous coucher avec moi ce soir? Sur le pont d'Avignon, on y danse. Oh là là! Puis soir, public de fonce de fumée. Chacun à son coup. Comme si. Comme ça.
Folie Bergère.
Beaujolais, nouveau. Châteauneuf de Pape, plat de jour. Noyer. Prêt?
Of course, Monsieur le Comte.
Why is she calling you a comte?
The gentleman would like some liquid refreshment.
Oh, follow him, Colonel.
Admiral, very well, Prime Minister. You've met my husband.
No, I don't think we've ever had that pleasure, but I'm sure we'll soon be staunch chums.
Judas!
No, Denis, with one N. Now, gentlemen, the fate of the Western world is in our hands. Shall we go in?
Money to burn. Get in there, Maurice.
The American envoy, Mr. Hamilton.
Mr. Thatcher, when the alcohol begins to trickle under the door, you will be the first to be informed.
Admiral Caton?
It's all right for you. You're not married.
Now, gentlemen, are you sitting comfortably? Then we'll begin.
The two men in there have entered under false pretenses. The true Monsieur Vouvray and the genuine Herr Schubert have just this second requested permission to land their helicopter.
As I thought. The sweepings of some suburban golf club.
Oh, come, Admiral. Perhaps not the companions one would choose for a stroll through the Dordogne, but nevertheless...
Oh, shut up, Jenkins.
If my hypothesis is correct, the Prime Minister could be trapped in there with two highly dangerous international terrorists.
Those two incontinent, cherry-nosed, unconscious terrorists?
This is the opportunity I've dreamed of ever since I was a raw recruit at Eton Staff College. The big one. One in the eye for the SAS. Lone PC for OBE. Oh, this act of gallantry. Her Majesty the Queen.
What do you intend to do, Inspector?
It is time the men of violence, Admiral, learnt their lesson. You, Jenkins, will go on serving lunch as if nothing had happened. It is vital their suspicions are not aroused.
Yes and no.
Now, whose side are you on, Smoothie Chops?
I see my position as being very much in the middle of the road.
Yeah, well, that's your funeral. Following on the impact of the explosion, stunning the gunman, I will effect an entry.
What explosion? What gunman?
I will plunge in, taking advantage of the confusion to neutralise the intruders and throw the Prime Minister out unscathed.
Wouldn't it be easier to knock on the door and ask if you can have a word?
That door is going to be blown out!
That door is listed in Pivsner.
Then it'll have to be the window. Who dares wings?
That window is pure Burne Jones.
Well, surely we can achieve some compromise.
I know what you're going to say, gentlemen. You're going to say, wipe out the small British businessman, and I agree with you.
Absolutely.
Go on, Jenkins. If what the inspector says is true, the Prime Minister could be brutally done away with.
Oh. Well, I suppose it's worth a try. A little light collation, gentlemen.
Oi! Get down! Get down!
Even Margaret stops talking from time to time. Then the solids are going to hit the air conditioning in no uncertain manner.
Front door. You're a mastermind. What to do?
Create a diversion. Start a fire. Or is Harrison.
But Moscow will make preemptive strike.
Mousse au saumon fumé, profiterole, cognac.
Of course the British have had it.
Monsieur le Comte, vous ferez de Chambertin, les deux synagogues, and Herr Schubert.
Philistine!
Stop it!
Gentlemen. Welcome to Tory Britain.
You rang, madam?
No, Jenkins, I did not.
Oh, perhaps some spontaneous tintin ablution brought about by the explosion.
There was no explosion, Jenkins. You know these old houses, gentlemen. I believe it's called settling down. Things that go bump in the night.
And bump in the day, it would seem.
Now, gentlemen, I think this calls for an explanation.
Oh, no, please.
You are 7.5 minutes late.
Forgive us, we were distributing food parcels to starving farmers in famine-affected areas of Wiltshire.
But how charming to find dear old Blighty, just as we Germans always like to picture it.
Denis! I've got a nasty feeling my husband's at the bottom of all this somewhere.
Very probably, ma'am. There is a considerable heap of debris still waiting to be cleared.
Now, gentlemen, if you'll follow me, I'll show you to your rooms. Then I want to speak to the inspector. Like Mr. Heseltine, he will keep taking initiatives.
Schubert! Vouvray! Always pleasant to renew friendships from old Brussels days, albeit under rather bizarre circumstances.
Monsieur Jenkins.
Yeah, Jenkins. I think you'll find you can rely on me when the time comes. Patience. Sooner or later, supreme power will drop into my lap like some ripe fruit.
Of course, we accept the Anglo-Saxon alliance with Washington.
Your relationship special with America.
It is not to be sneezed over.
Oh, no. It is of vital importance.
But we are here to cement European solidarity.
Like the three musty queers. All for one.
And who knows? Perhaps a bit of the other.
Of course.
Psst! Boom, 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 boom. Attention, the bush.
Of course. Auf Wiedersehen.
Hello.
Beware the slippery frog.
Indeed. A tout à l'heure.
Not a woman I would ever trust.
A terrorist in navy blue knickers. Bill.
Oh, as weekends go, I have known more successful ones. Well, lacking the brush of a Leonardo da Vinci, I find it rather hard to paint an adequate picture. Suffice it to say that were you to arrive at this precise moment, you'd be about as welcome as a peddler flogging rubber johnnies at the front door of a monastery during a papal visit. No, the proprietor has just trickled upstairs to practice her killer looks in the bedroom mirror. I'm almost afraid, Bill, one of these days she may turn herself to stone. What has displeased her apart from yours truly, woman? Oh, minor irritations. The drawing room blew up. Lower orders threatening revolution. Maurice Picardo and the Major identified as dangerous international terrorists and arrested. No, Bill, they talked their way into it. They can bloody well talk their way out of it. Oh, I imagine they'll fall against various unyielding objects while assisting the police with their inquiries, and then be sentenced to several years of penal servitude. And certain damn well right, in my opinion, that's what happens when you try getting mixed up in politics. No, they all end up in Chokey, in my experience, with or without a seat in the House of Lords. Either that or raving barmy, like poor old Wedgwood Ben, he of the permanently revolving eyes. Well, Bill, if I can break through the Gestapo-style security cordon, I'm intending to trickle out for a little drink. How you got to Ashby de la Zouche, I will not attempt to understand. But were you to join me in the snug bar of the wagon load of monkeys in Great Missenden, no, Bill, Missenden, I might be prepared to buy you a largish Snorterino de Luxe. Oh, reservoir to you, too.
Please, Mr. Dennis.
Ah, Boris.
As a Soviet agent, I've no experience for an assignment. Until recently, political commissar, Gum Department Store, Red Square. Haberdashery, soft furnishing.
Boris, make
it. Coat. Moments ago, I radioed Moscow Control reporting massive build-up Western world potential. Now I learn that forces all across the plains of Mother Russia are summoned to the alert, and I, Boris Alexeyevich Bakunin, am responsible for the Nutslu destruction of the entire globe.
Hat.
Lakes and forests, snow-capped mountains, tropical seas, pullulating with weather, a brilliant life.
Not that one, Boris. You'll get me back on the front page of Gay News.
And on all sides, I hear the voices of antiquity. Shakespeare, Pascal, Pushkin, Tolstoy. Why have you done this thing? Why have you allowed this thing to happen?
For pity's sake, Boris, stop bothering me with trivialities. I'm trying to get down to the boozer for a drink.
Boozer?
Take off that ridiculous garment this minute. There's work to be done. It's all hands on deck, Mr. Thatcher. Jenkins and his band of hooligan revolutionaries are on the rampage in the servants' hall, and there's no place here for idle swabs. Don't think for one minute I'm ignorant of where the blame is to be laid for this barbarian outrage. No doubt there was some feeble-minded toper asked his friends round the night they burned the great library at Alexandria. Some husband smoking in the lavatory the evening the Parthenon exploded. Chequers, this seat of democratic majesty, this shrine of high ideals, laid waste, looking like the Connaught Rooms after a dinner given by the 1922 committee. I know what you're thinking. You're thinking there must be one telephone kiosk in the neighborhood we haven't vandalized. Or are you toying with the idea that you might wreck Westminster Abbey and still be in the saloon bar by opening time?
Make mine a large one.
If I had my way, you'd both be sitting in the stocks being pelted with motorway food.
You would think, wouldn't you, in this day and age, that the police had something better to do than go around blowing up people's lounge rooms looking for parking offenders.
Lead up. I think I can devise a scheme for your escape, but it will require cunning, some disguise, and split-second timing.
Now what are you talking about?
Well, you saw the film of Coleridge, The Wooden Horse. Now, the name of the game is Tunnels.
If you think, Thatcher, that I am going to shuffle around with yellow sand dribbling out the bottom of my trouser legs for the pleasure of your company in the snug, you are clearly ripe for the funny farm. In my opinion, you have behaved like a cad and a bounder. No, Maurice, I intend to get this off my chest. It is my considered conclusion, sir, that you are not quite a gent.
Well, I happen to be all information
not
to
quite
be
a
chatter,
a
chatter,
gent,
chatter. It amazes me that men left alone have ever accomplished anything. Clear up that mess. Captain Scott and his band of bearded gasbags gossiping their way towards the pole. A party of wrens could have got there and back in half the time. I shall return at irregular and unscheduled intervals.
Not quite a gent, sir.
While we're on that topic, it might interest you to know that at the last Tory party conference, when I wasn't on parade on the platform, having to try and look compos after lunch, grin like a baboon, hurl myself about in paroxysms of applause every time that frightful four-letter fellow Heseltine opened his trap, I met a friend of yours called Palmer, who was in the army with you in Caterham in 1944. And he told me, would you believe this, Boris, that you weren't a major at all. You were a company sergeant major. I see the bed in store in the RASC, which, as we both know, stands for runaway, someone's coming.
There is a law of libel in this country to deal with allegations of this gravity, Thatcher. I've a damn good mind to set my man, Lord Goodman, onto you personally.
Still no sign of Mr. Reagan's emissary. How are things below stairs, Admiral?
Mr. Wu is staging a sit-in in the only restroom left undamaged by the blast. Old Adam, I fear, is in the potting shed. He's taking industrial action.
Honestly, at his age, have they no loyalty?
Revolting entrails of the body politic. Military intervention's an ugly word, but tip me the wink and I'll go through them like a dose of salt.
Thank you, Admiral.
Ah! The good old British Bobby on the beat. Oh, leader, when all these bungling incompetents have let you down, remember there's a shoulder here for you to weep upon. We women must stick together.
I bet she said the same to Edward Heath. Not hurt, I hope, Inspector.
Only a flesh wound, madam. Acting in what I believe to be the public interest, I had the honour of shooting myself through the foot 119 times. Both Mr. Jenkins and myself were treated by the local vet.
The vet? What was he doing here?
By happy coincidence, madam, he was down in the Neville Chamberlain coppice, gassing badgers.
But why the vet?
You may remember, madam, you bulldozed the cottage hospital.
Oh, yes, wearing rather a pretty hat and long white gloves. Now, I'd like to speak to the prisoners, Inspector.
All right, that's hands off them, let's be having you.
European councillors, indeed. I know a criminal when I see one. And no one gets past Eric Catchpole.
Now, I'm expecting the envoy of the United States of America. I'm entertaining representatives from two of the most powerful nations in the European alliance, and the entire staff is at a standstill. They'll get the impression I couldn't run a whelk stall. Now, you know that isn't true.
Of course.
But what is the use of being the most consistently wise leader in the Western world? A leader who is always, and without exception, right? When there are no workers left to lead. And that is where you come in. Now, Denis, Herr Schubert would like a nice strong cup of English tea to calm his nerves, and Monsieur Vouvray wants his shoes cleaned.
Well, I'm sure little Jenkins will be only too delighted to oblige, darling. After all, he's there to hand us everything on a plate.
Don't argue, Denis.
Tea for Kraut. Frog would like me to trickle up and lick his boots. I think I get the picture.
Inspector, I want a 1,000% increase in our security arrangements.
OBE, George Medal. Arise, Sir Eric Catchpole, youngest Metropolitan Police Commissioner in history. 30, 40 years of golden retirement doing tire commercials.
You run along, Inspector. Back to work, gentlemen.
May I say just one thing, ma'am?
Well?
You are looking at two of your most passionate admirers, right, Maurice?
Passionate.
Like many of your loyal subjects, Maurice here frequently wakes in the middle of the night screaming your name.
Screaming?
That's all very well, but how am I to run this country when everyone keeps sabotaging my efforts?
How are you to run this country? I have had dreams in which you ask me that question. May I crave just 60 seconds of your valuable time, ma'am?
Very well.
Have you ever thought of sterilizing the entire working class?
I think that might be rather a difficult one.
Helicopters, crop spraying techniques?
I meant electorally, we could lose valuable votes.
Ah, you are a woman of principle, enough said.
But I like your thinking, Mr.
Major, WHS Jump, Managing Director, Whoopi Party Hats and Novelties of Croydon Limited, and Mr. Picarda, who is in solar eating, double glazing, and currently liquidation.
How do you do, Mr. Picarda? Now, Major, I want to pick your brains.
I'll fetch you a pair of tweezers and a microscope.
Right, down to brass tacks. What people want to know is what is happening in words of one syllable.
Unquestionably. You see, the passionate businessman today. Shackles, hand and foot. Right? The man in taxi. Strike off the shackle. Say 15% flat rate. With your multi-millionaire or pensioner living in Merionethshire. So, you have the enterprise. We will give you the freedom.
Oratory is not enough, Maurice.
If you had told me in the smoking ruins of Berlin in 1945, when these people were still flogging their wives and grandmothers for a packet of Woodbine Willys, that I shall spend my declining years truckling to the Bosch and performing humiliating chores for Johnny Frog, I will say to a barking man.
Fascinating. I am here to put your English diseases under the magnifying glass. You are a working man.
How dare you!
You are the middle chamber potmate here! You bring up my tea, stone cold, your thumb in the milk jug. A surly but tempered expression wrinkling your physog. You do not call me sir. Or say, have a nice day.
Why else I want you to have a nice day? You realize all this schmozzle with the yobs is your fault, didn't you? Friend of mine called Fatty Farmer, he was in bomber command during the war, personally responsible, actually, for knocking out that cathedral place you used to have in Dresden. Spot a plane in, wallop, piece of cake. Mind you, Fatty was an artist. Come the end of the war, goes into second-hand washing machines and is wiped out. All because you lot of crop-headed zombies believe in working 24 hours a day to make us look BFs. I hate a lot of you.
A diplomat. Pissed.
Unfortunately not. Would that I were. I haven't had a drink all day.
Shushan, the American delegation is arrived.
Well?
It is essential for my purposes with your Prime Minister that I should have, how you say, first bite of her cherry.
What exactly have you got in mind?
Perhaps these will make you more amenable.
Certainly not. My friend Prince Bernhard of the Netherlands burnt his fingers very badly on that kind of caper.
What a charmingly moral little boots.
I am not your little boots! All the same, aren't you, you froggy onion peddlers? You've never really forgiven us, British, after the fall of France, for failing to collapse in sympathy. Especially any reason you switched the location of this conference was to come over and ransack Marks and Sparks' Jin's underwear department. It was a good one.
Oi, Four Eyes,
What do you think when you look in that glass?
But wealth is possibly concentrated in the wrong hands, sir.
You may think that, Jenkins. I think, hello, and that's pissed in it.
Do be more liberal, Roy.
Patience.
Major.
Here we go, then. Some post-monetarist guidelines.
Oh, I like post. It suggests continuity with flexibility.
By Dr. Maurice Picard of the University of Central Australia.
I've no idea Maurice had a doctorate.
An aunt in Brisbane died and left it to him.
I wonder who left Dr. Ian Paisley here.
Oh, do pipe down, Denis, and leave this to the experts.
Experts?
Monsieur Bouvray's shoes are not going to clean themselves.
Frogs? I thought they had flippers.
No, we turn to unemployment, your finest achievement. It's an old wrinkle from army days. Other ranks get stroppy about fatigues. Line them up, PT kit and plimsolls, march them out into the snow, leave them there for a couple of nights. After that, they're only too glad to come back inside and scrub out a nice warm carthy.
You don't think that's too Keynesian a solution? You see, Major, one of our election pledges was to reduce unemployment. Obviously, I don't give a damn for election pledges, but I am rather committed to the idea of no U-turns.
U-turn? Well, it wasn't a U-turn, officer. It was more like an adjustment.
What did Mr. Picard say?
He was talking about a bit of strife we had on the way down here, coming off the motorway. He was saying that it wasn't a U-turn, more of an adjustment.
Oh, I don't mind my advisors performing U-turns.
You don't.
But I am the leader. I cannot be seen to be dithering. I must be out there in the fast lane, headlights on, horn blaring.
Right, with you.
Foot down, shouting to the slow coaches. Out of my way, I've got a bigger car than you have.
North one up onto the central reservations of Sicily.
I've got more money than you have.
Up on two wheels, smell of burning rubber.
I deserve the road to myself.
Oh, three wheelers, wallop them off the road, wallop, wallop, wallop.
Straight on up the motorway.
You out there in front, stuck up like the silver lady on the bonnet of the road.
No L drivers, no pedestrians, no invalid carriages.
Leading forward, eating up the road.
Needle off the speedometer, hogging the fast lane. Oh, that vision I had as a young girl in my father's grocery shop in Grantham. Up and up and up that motorway, leaving Grantham and the grocery shop far behind. The clean wind in my ears, off and away to a bigger world. A world of bigger hats and bigger handbags. A bit like Harrods, really. All power to the people who can afford it. No U-turns!
And do you wonder Mark became a racing driver?
The spirit of the Falklands.
Oh, if only we could bring that spirit to bear on the militant unions.
Ooh, leave them to me, Mom. Sensitivity, kid gloves. But by the time I have finished yomping up and down on them work-shy swine, they will cost the very name of Anthony Wedgwood Bin.
Thank you, Major. Now, Mr. Picarda, you and I can go upstairs and powder our noses.
Go on, Maurice, get on with it.
Why don't you start with old Adam the gardener, Major? You'll find him in the potting shed.
Major, such sentiments may be all very well in the saloon bar of the Cat and Hamster, but here they could be highly dangerous.
No, Thatcher. Elizabeth I had Sir Walter Raleigh. Queen Victoria had her Dizzy. And now that wonderful woman has got me.
Hello, Charlie.
Chummy, I happen to be the brains behind Mrs. Thatcher's economic strategy.
You might fool the Prime Minister, son, but you don't fool me. Motoring offenders, ring a bell. I've already arrested one of them. Bit of a knock on the head during the raid. Can't remember where I put him. But you step one inch outside this building, you'll have the law down on you like a ton of bricks. Crunch.
Ah, stop.
Bloody kraut. That's all we needed.
I've had jet lag before, but never as bad as this.
Ah, Ronnie Reagan's more intelligent younger brother. Margaret!
May I speak with Mrs. Thresher?
Thatcher!
The Zuntite. Yeah, I think I've just had one of my blackouts. To be frank, I've had trouble with this before. When I led the last high-level mission to Moscow, the battery fell out of my pacemaker just when I was talking to the old guy with the eyebrows.
Brezhnev!
Hay fever?
You must know, Brother Brezhnev has my entire sympathy. You spent the last 25 years nephelming everything that moves from Saigon to El Salvador. The moment Moscow starts one little Afghan war or takes a sound line with the Unions in Poland, you start bellyaching like a nun in a knocking shop. Here we are, supposed to be our oldest allies, i.e. buried up to here in Yankee hamburger stands and intercontinental ballistic missiles. The moment it comes to the crunch with the Argies, you can't see old Hopalong's ass for dust. Up against you lot, the Russians honestly can't know if they are crouched over the porcelain or combing their hair.
Well, of course, this is a valid point of view and we respect it, Mr. Nutt. Mr. Nutt? My God, the commies have got him.
A strange sense of deja vu. Excuse me, sir. I wonder if you'd be so kind as to blow into this bag.
I never travel without my own medication.
Very well, if you're going to be obstreperous about it, I shall take you in on sus, pending a urine examination.
Well, of course, this also is a valid point of view, and we respect it.
Margaret. Margaret?
Thatcher. Place is surrounded by ravening dogs.
Major, wait here. I'm on the track of some kind of disguise that should enable you to make good your escape.
Oh, boy, you're a gent.
Not so fast, Herr Major.
Margaret. Margaret. The American emissary. Old Grandpa Moses.
Where?
Well, it was here a moment ago.
Denis, have you been drinking?
How could I have been drinking, woman?
I didn't hear that, Denis.
Don't care a lot, and that's a fact.
Mr. Fifth, we really must begin our talks.
Talks? Waffle? Hot air? Action is what is needed. A fist of steel to reach out and grasp this land of ours until its eyes water.
Oh, I remember Chequers in the old days, when Britain had a role and stood alone. Hooded headlights searching down the leafy lanes of Berkshire, sirens wailing on the soft night air, brass hats wrapping grateful fingers round mugs of cocoa in the map room. Then Winston. He gave me his cigar to hold. I think it was his cigar.
One day, all this will be mine.
Ah, there you are, Jenkins.
Sir?
Jenkins, you always struck me as being a very agreeable sort of cove.
Thank you, sir.
I'd say you'd agree to practically anything, wouldn't you?
Well, sir, I think one must seek out support for a moderate line wherever possible. And if it's a question of obeying the biblical injunction to make friends of the mammon of unrighteousness, I suppose one should agree to almost anything.
Right, get your trousers down.
My trousers?
Your trousers. I need them for a Tory friend of mine who is on the run from the police.
Oh, very well, sir.
I blame Wolfenden.
What is your explanation, Jenkins? Pressure of work?
No, it's a tradition in this type of Whitehall farce. It's a form of homage to Brian Ricks.
They'd never allow this on the BBC.
Up trousers and avast behind.
More and more fascinating.
Come on, sunshine, I haven't got all day.
I sometimes find that whistling does the trick. Would you mind?
Prime Minister!
Ah, Herr Schubert, in the absence of Mr. Thurston.
Strange advisors you have. Bing, vertically up the exterior. Then hoopla, in through the window. The Major.
Major?
Bare belly, broken veins, bloodshot eyes, made the big bags.
Willie Whitelaw, Jim Pryor, could be practically any member of my cabinet.
He talked at first good common sense.
Ah, that does rather narrow the field. Oh, you mean the Major?
Yeah, the Major. He showed me his old man.
Did he?
Yeah, through the window. Old Adam, the gardener. This old man, he's having a stroke.
Strike. But the effect is very much the same, I agree.
This Major tells me he is a schramstinker.
Scrimshanker. Yes, it means a hopeless, incompetent, idle layabout. I don't expect you have a word for it in German.
Oh, yeah. We call them British workers.
Oh, that's not fair, is it, everyone? No. Only a tiny minority are troublemakers. They're politically motivated. Nobody else is motivated at all. Now, shall we go in?
Maybe your people here believe that, but you know the truth. You even tell it to them sometimes.
You must be more competitive, you Nagatan, in your shrill English voice. You are a lot of idle schwein. Stand on your own back legs. I wash my hands with you afterwards.
I think you are quoting me out of context, Herr Schubert.
I will quote you verbatim the words of your advisor. Every maniac of them is a forking idle beggar at heart. I personally, old fruit, would guess the lot of them.
I cannot be held responsible for every statement that comes out of Tory Party Central Office. Now.
This major tells me he was never under his desk before 11 in the morning.
At his desk.
He was prone.
Oh, I see.
To liberal alcoholic indulgence throughout the morning. Always allowed 3 hours for lunch. And reckoned to be tucked up in bed by 4:30 with a bit of stuffing from Streatham. And for this, he expected to be paid the earth and have everything else thrown in on top of him.
Because, Herr Schubert, as Tories, we believe in encouraging enterprise and initiative.
So why you give money to this idle schwein?
Not to mention your nationalized industries. You are an enigma to me, Frau Thatcher. An enigma of which I intend to get to the bottom before the odious Frenchman sticks his nose into it.
Goodbye, ceiling. Goodbye, table. Goodbye, floor. Goodbye, Admiral Sensible Black Brogues. Goodbye, Admiral Sturt the Blue Sand.
Take your hands off me. I'm not a towel dispenser.
Already across the Urals, the hatches of the missile silos are sliding back. The grim-faced heroes of the Red Army, their faces lit by the eerie glow of the radar screens, are at this moment plotting the awful logarithms of destruction. Soon, soon to engulf the entire planet. And I... Boris Alexeyevich Bakunin, I'm guilty of this almighty crime!
What did you say?
You want I should repeat it?
No, just the gist. I'm a busy woman and my heart is sore.
Russia is poised to attack.
Are you a cretin?
Ukrainian.
Have you been living down a hole for the last 35 years? Why am I wearing this uniform? Why do our gallant ships and submarines plough the foaming main and nose its gurgling depths by night and day, constantly on patrol, burning up a large proportion of our gross national product?
But Mr. Dennis said there would be snorts and snifters, tinctures, lotions, G&Ts.
Talking through his hat as usual, there's no question of any alcohol now. You have my personal assurance.
You mean snifters, etc. is only booze? Oh, Admiral, can this be true?
Sea Scout's honor.
Admiral. Spasibo. Spasibo.
Beast!
How very embarrassing. Try to pretend I wasn't here.
Prime Minister.
I'm not a prude, Admiral. From time to time, we women need a bit of trouser.
If you say so, Prime Minister.
La belle Maggie. Quick, while the Bosch is absent.
My dear Madam Prime Minister.
Oh, Monsieur Bouvray.
Oh, Maggie, what is it about you that as a Frenchman I find so fascinating, so irresistible? Your eyes so sharp and piercing. Your voice the same. Your immense deposits of oil wealth beneath the North Sea. Your codfish.
Oh, Monsieur Bouvray, my husband.
Le Mari, he has caught me with his épouse.
Now, Monsieur Bouvray, this is not the time or the place for such discussions. If you'll join Herr Schubert and myself, we really must get down to business.
One moment, madame.
Very well, but time is of the essence.
You seem to be experiencing some difficulties with supplies of alcohol.
How very observant of you.
So, you are not the Boots. You are Denis Thatcher.
It is pronounced Thatcher.
Ah, wait. The tongue between the teeth.
You keep your garlic-coated tongue to yourself.
Ah, Denise, mon cher, you are a jealous husband.
What?
No. Don't deny it. Who has the key to this cupboard?
Oh, the Admiral, the military.
I can obtain it for you, this key. But I would ask one favor in exchange. Allow me one moment alone with your wife.
You call that a favor? You get me anything I can stuff a corkscrew into, you can have her for the duration.
Huh. Will this do?
Oui, oui. C'est parfait.
Denise, mon cher, a little something to be wetting your whistlings in the meanwhile.
116 years ago, our fathers brought forth upon this continent several new nations dedicated to the proposition that all men are created capitalists.
Sample.
I gave it to the nurse.
You know the alternative? Blood.
Not over the carpet.
Sorry, Admiral.
If there's blood to be shed, shed it outside. The roses are crying out for it.
Mon ami, what is it about you that as a Frenchman I find so fascinating, so irresistible?
I presume I have something you want.
You are a matelot, a sea dog. I will phrase it in your nautical jargon. I want to splice your main braces. To celebrate, throw open your calve.
My calve? Oh, you mean my cellar?
I mean your cupboard.
Not without permission of the Prime Minister.
In matters of this kind, my jolly old tar, Europe does not have to consult your so-called ironing lady. If we wish to crush you fiscally with the VAT, if we decide to torment you with the cap...
The what?
A common agricultural policy. Already we have decimalized you. We have abolished your ancient currency and given you the P. At present, when you have a sore throat, you suck a lozenge. Soon we will introduce by law our new exocet-style suppositoire.
No! Anything, but not that. That is the key.
Merci.
I've always had my doubts about French bottling regulations.
Oh, perhaps it was a little young. Have the next one, as you say, all over me. Voila. For this one moment alone with your wife, a bargain is a bargain.
A bargain, from my point of view, will fruit 100% clear-blooded profit.
Now, to complete my seduction, soon all the fabulous oil of the North Sea will flood into my crutch.
Coolie.
Fine moment, Herr Schubert.
Bum, 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 bum.
Oh, Monsieur Bouvray.
Do you not remember the days of our intimacy? The pulsing heart of London, whilst we of the resistance supplied by jolly winkos of the RAF with sparkling eyes and moustache a l'andelbar fought on in the dark. Oh, the beau jour.
I was a mere food research chemist at the time.
Prime Minister!
Maggie. Meet me in the pavilion at the bottom of the garden beneath the old oak. Voila. The so-called metal virgin melts in my hand like a chocolat drop. Vive l'amour.
Vive la France. But vive, above all else, the money.
Frau Führer, you are perfect.
Oh, really, Herr Schubert?
Frau Führer, a woman with your potential must cut herself loose from this decaying corpse.
Oh, I could never leave Denis.
I mean this England! This offshore rubbish dump! This sink of filth-breeding corruption and industrial discontent! Maybe we got bogged down in the coolie fish.
Yes.
When I speak of Europe, I speak of... a flag, a banner, and you, Margaret Hilda, will seize that flag, planting one hobnail boot on the grasping fingers of the agricultural bundles of Paris, when then, Margaret Hilda, Margaret Hilda, Margaret... Margaret?
You're not imagining anything, Thatcher.
Are you unhinged?
How else am I supposed to get out of this place? Rozzers all round the building, walk out the front door, bleeding great wolfhound tears the arse out of me trousers, nothing else to wear.
You mad baboon?
Can't fail, worked it out. Now, whistle up a chauffeur, tell him to drive round the front, you and I will then march straight up.
Arm in arm, Esther.
Right.
I see.
No one will dream of stopping me dressed like this.
Frau Führer.
Still on.
You are like no one else in this pigsty. You are a different animal, an eager beaver. Be our beaver in Europe. Ruthless, blindingly efficient, the erotic English nanny. The avenging goddess of the old North myths. Margaret Hilda, Margaret Hilda.
Bugger off.
With our diligent workforce and your austere leadership, we will conquer the world.
Mrs. Roofer.
Scheiße.
An intruder?
Mrs. Reagan will be very moved when I describe this domestic scene. You clearly still enjoy a very physical relationship.
Shevel! You stand together? Thin through thick. Ready to give Imperial Washington
A boot in the eye and a poke up the backside she will never forget.
Your husband must be a great support to you, Mrs. Screecher. Could I ask you to pose for a Polaroid? It's for a book that Nancy hands round after dinner at the White House.
The proudest moment of my life. You want us entwined in a love embrace. Just holding hands.
That's just fine.
You filthy Drummond pervert.
I love you when you are in this teasing mood.
Before Vouvray rambles, we have booked it off. It's a pavilion at the bottom of the garden.
In 1 minute. Margaret Hilda! Margaret Hilda!
Hilda!
All right, Major, let me handle this.
We go again. I reckon I screwed up the focus. It may be from a more controversial angle. Hold it. Would you mind holding hands again?
Holding the eyes. You told me that you were the power behind the throne. You know what you are, don't you, Thatcher?
Yeah?
You are a prize winker.
Be that as it may, I have ordered a limousine for your escape. Right. Wait until I give the signal, and until then, for God's sake, try and look as normal as possible.
I have saved the world.
Come on, you mad bugger.
Denis, have you been drinking?
No, darling, I think it's what Reggie Boson gets called the touch of epilepsy.
One more time.
Mr. Fisk, you're here at last. You must have had a terrible time getting here. From now on, you're going to experience some real British hospitality. Come into the conference room.
Bloody, bloody Wolfstar.
Quick.
Mr. Fizz. Denis, do I know this gentleman?
No, darling, he's just come out of the closet.
The prison girl is like a melody. It haunts you night and day. I've always had my doubts about Maurice.
Hello, darlings. How do you like the frock?
Denis, who are these persons?
Your economic advisors, darling. And my very close friends. If you need us, we shall be in the snog bar of the Wigan Load of Minkies in Great Mussenden.
May I just say, ma'am, others may doubt your competence, but we know that you are one of us.
One of us.
Boys!
When you're as strapped for cash as we are in the SDP, all contributions gratefully received.
Off to take over security at Buckingham Palace, I presume.
Mrs. Thatcher? Thatcher?
How kind.
Thanks to me, the blue globe of Earth still floats on in its lacy veil of cloth.
So I was right not to wake the president.
I mean, jumping Jehoshaphat, woman. All I've been trying to do the whole weekend is to get a wee dram of giggle water with the old chummies. There can't be many men in the Western Hemisphere whose retirement has been entirely fouled up by our wife becoming prime minister.
Oh, Denis. I've underestimated you.
Oh, I don't know about
that. No, don't argue, Denis. From now on, things are going to be different. Oh, and Denis, I shall be upstairs.